Hello.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, everyone.
Buenas noches a todos. Perdón.
No, very good. Estamos aquí en Cracovia 32 con el joven, el maestro, la leyenda, Chazz Young. Y pues vamos a platicar sobre su vida, ciertas inspiraciones de él con su padre, Frankie Manning, y sus historias en el show business de jazz y tap and things like that. So I think, Chazz, we're gonna start maybe by having you introduce yourself, where you come from, where you started, and why are you here in Mexico?
Okay, first, my name is Chazz Young, but one of my teachers, his name was Honey Cold. He used to call me Chazz, C-H-S, which is the abbreviation of Charles. So I said I wanted to like have a professional name, a stage name. So I said, I think I like Chazz, that's part of my name. So I added C-H-A, instead of the S, I put a Z. Then I said, oh, I want two Z's. I want to get fancy, you know. Zorro. Yes, and I was born and raised in Harlem. And in Harlem, it's a lot of dance at the time. This was back in 1932. Boy, that was a long time ago.
1932, claro.
And there was lots of dancing around. I didn't start dancing until my mother took me to a theater in Manhattan. It was called the Roxy Theater. And my father was, with his group, was performing there. Now, that was my first live show. I was 10 years old. And I had never seen a live show before. I hadn't seen any shows before. That was my first show, and here was my dad with these girls, tossing the girls. They were doing the Lindy Hop. I didn't know what they were doing, but the girls were flying all over the stage. They had colorful costumes, and the lights was colorful. All I know, that was the most exciting thing I had ever seen. So at the end of the performance, my mother turned to me and asked me, do I think I would like to be on the stage like my father? I don't know, I just said yes. I just said yes. I see excitement, I never seen all of that before. Just something told me to say yes. I could have said no, but I said yes. So in 2 years, I don't know, 2 years went by and my mother put me into dancing school. So that was my very first experience going to a dancing school to learn tap. And the name of the lady that was had the school, her name was Mary Bruce, on 125th Street and St. Nicholas Avenue in Harlem.
Mary Bruce.
Yeah. And it was a large dancing school. There was lots of girls, lots of boys. And they had a boys' class separate from the girls. So that's when I started learning how to tap dance.
You mentioned earlier today that you had actually started with ballet. Was that before tap, or was that somewhere?
After.
That was after.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, in this particular school, you not only learn tap, you did a little bit of acrobatics, you get a little bit of ballet, a little bit of what else? A Lindy Hop. Because that's when I learned how to just to do a swing out, an 8-count swing out. That's all they taught, just to get you for social dancing.
And then, so Frankie didn't teach you your first swing out?
No.
No.
My dad had an act called, at that time, I think they were Whitey's Maniacs or Lindy Hoppers or something like that. And they were the best. And they kept working, you know, when they finish one job, they'll go to another job. So I didn't see him very much at all.
There was another name for the group, was Whitey's Maniacs?
Yes.
Ah, okay. So en esos años, con este grupo eran los mejores, y pues ellos siguieron con este show, y, and that way he was busy doing his show.
Yes, yes. He stayed on the road because that was the best Lindy Hop act out there. My dad, Norman wasn't in that, it was four of them. It was Russell, Billy Ricker, and Norma Miller. Wait, no. And somebody,
somebody incredible.
I don't recall the other two, but I know Willamay was one, and then there was another lady, because I was referring to Norma in Hell's the Poppin'. But I'm just saying that my dad was very, very, very busy traveling, so I didn't see much of him. But, you know, people that knew my dad and knew that I was his son, they always spoke very, very, very well of him. I never heard anything bad about my father, so that made me feel very, very good. And he was an excellent dancer doing the Lindy Hop. So I said that because I wanted to be as good or better than my dad. And that drove me to start practicing all the time. So I was 12 years old and I started practicing a lot, and this meant that my teacher noticed me, and she made me a teacher, and I started teaching at 15. The youngsters, you know, the other new kids started coming in. I watch Powell, how she practices, and the other fella, that, you know, the juggling, and you must do that constantly. You just must do that. Because if you want to be good, that's what you have to do. So I practiced and practiced, and I became a teacher. So as I said, I start teaching the other young boys that start coming in on Saturday morning. And so my mother didn't have to pay for me anymore once I started teaching, and that was a good thing. So now the years went on. We did every year there's a recital that they put on a show. And when Frankie came in town, he came to see me perform at Carnegie Hall.
In the famous place in New York, right?
Yes, so she would, like on a Sunday, she would rent it out for that particular day to put her dance school in the Carnegie Hall. Wow. So my dad came and he watched me dance and he watched me dance. Like I said, I didn't see him very much. So when I reached the age of 17, he knew that Norma Miller was looking for some boys and some girls to form the Norma Miller Dancers. So he brought me to meet Norma Miller.
How old is Norma Miller right now?
She's 96.
96 años ahora. Is
still performing. She doesn't dance a lot, but she's a comedian.
Sí. Hace comedia.
Ya no baila.
Ya no baila,
sorry?
Can I ask something?
Yes.
Just for a little bit of context, what was the year?
1983.
Okay.
1983? No. We're going further back than that.
Oops.
In 1942, I was 10 years old. So let's say 49. Yeah.
Okay.
And I joined Norma at 17, and I celebrated my 18th birthday in Caracas, Venezuela. They took this big show to Caracas, Venezuela with my dad's act there, so in this big group of dancers.
You were part of the company that was there performing.
Part of the Norma Miller dancers.
Sí, los bailarines de Norma Miller tuvieron haciendo ese show ahí.
They had other acts, again, Frankie and his act, and then other acts, singers and other dancers and comedians and jugglers and acrobatics.
Wow.
Yes, it was a big show. We were away for 8 weeks. Yeah, so that went on. I was with Norma Miller. We traveled different places and performed different places. But it got very expensive to carry the girls. So there were four guys and four girls. So she had to let the girls go and form the act Norma Miller and the Four Jazzmen. You got all of that?
What was the name of the Norma Miller and the what?
Four Jazzmen.
Was it expensive just because of the quantity of dancers to have the ladies along?
Well, costumes, extra costumes.
Everything
and things,
that,
yes.
Yeah, that involved from the production point.
Yeah, and transportation.
Uh-huh. So originally it was a show of eight people.
Yes.
And then it dropped down to five with Norman.
Yes,
and four.
Norman, yeah, right.
Uh-huh. But who else was on that team? Who were the other guys?
Okay, Billy Ricker, who had danced with Norma in Hell's a Poppin'. And Billy Dodson, a fellow named Billy Dodson, and myself. So that's Billy Ricker, Billy Dodson, Raymond Scott, and myself. Those were the four.
Mm-hmm.
See, before we did all types of dancing. We did interpretive dancing, African type dancing. But once we became an act, then we put on suits and ties and we changed the act around, make it Norma Miller and the Four Jazzmen, and
right.
We did jazz, more jazz steps and acrobatics.
Right. Is there any material from those days? Is there any?
Unfortunately,
any
no. If there was, believe me, I would have it. Honestly, yes, they just aren't any.
That'd be amazing to see. And where did you tour with that show besides Venezuela?
Oh, that show came back to New York, and we went into the Apollo Theater. That's what my debut, when we came back from that tour, we went into the Apollo with Count Basie, Norma Miller, and her dancers. That was still part of Norma Miller dancers when we came back from Caracas, Venezuela. So, shortly after that, this would take all night if I went every detail.
Oh,
so I'm just skipping, you know, we travel everywhere. We were with Olson and Johnson. Olson and Johnson was like Abbott and Costello. Do anybody remember? No, But if you've seen Hell's a Poppin', yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Most of you have seen Hell's a Poppin' with the Lindy Hop scene, yes?
Yeah.
Well, you seen two zany guys, two comedians, they were Olson and Johnson. So anyway, we went on a skating show, a roller skating show, not ice skating. We didn't put on any skates, but we were the dancers in that show. And so we did three numbers. We did the jazz number, we did two African type number, and then a finale style jazz number with Norma doing from the Lindy Hop, she and Billy. We all did a little bit of Lindy Hop. And that's what we did. We traveled in all the major cities in the United States. Mm-hmm. So then after that we came back, that's when things started getting expensive, the traveling, and she changed the act to Norma Miller and the Four Jazzmen. And we toured all of Australia, London, and the last time we went to Australia, we stayed for 8 weeks, and we came back, and this was 1964, and there was no more jobs in sight, because the music started to change, and in the States, they were bringing in rock and roll bands. Rock and roll was very big. The guitars started coming out. The wires were all over the floor. We had one gig, and we had to watch out because of the wires to the guitars and things. But we did that one gig, but that was it. So Norma said, well, we're going to go our own way. So that stopped, and I was married, and I had kids, and I had to work. So I started driving a taxi cab, and my dad, he was in the post office because he had stopped dancing, stopped traveling, and he told me that they were hiring in the post office. I went down, took the test. They didn't call me for 2 years. So I drove cab. I take a cab out at 6 o'clock in the morning. I drove to like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I'd have my dinner. And I went back and I drove again from like 6 to midnight. I had to make money. I started working and it wasn't enough just from 8 in the morning until like 4. So I went back out, I went back out until midnight. So anyway, I did that for those 2 years. I went in the post office. I would go by and see my dad, and I would go. And at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I finished at 11 o'clock, and then that's when my dad and I, we would hang out. We start becoming very close then, because he worked in Manhattan, the largest post office there on 33rd Street, and I would go and see him. And he would always tell me, well, there's a party coming up Saturday. Do you want to go? I say, yeah, because he always has some fine chicks. Always has some fine chicks at these parties, so I was right there. Anyway, the Cat Club. You have heard of the Cat Club. I'm skipping because I'll be here all night. This particular club had opened, and this is when they first started seeing a little bit of swing. Well, there was one big television a commercial that during the commercial they would advertise the Gap clothing.
Khaki swing.
Yeah. And that sort of caught on.
¿Ustedes conocen este anuncio?
¿Qué año era?
What year was that come out? That was in the 90s, no? I guess it was mid-90s?
About 89.
It was 89?
Yeah. About around there, 89. Is he writing the book?
Yeah, he's writing the book.
You can leave that sentence out. No, go ahead. You can look it up. You get the ambassador of the Lindy Hop, Frankie Manning. Yeah. What I'm getting ready to say was that Frankie was still in the post office, and people were going to this Cat Club, and Frankie had acquired, gathered a lot of sick leave, And he was getting ready to retire, but not yet. But the one thing you should not do is to go out sick and you are not sick. So when he would go out sick and he was in the cat club. So they were taking pictures that night. They were taking pictures and these pictures came in the newspapers. And then somebody called up and said, Frankie, you're in the newspapers, the Sunday newspaper. He said, what? He said, yeah, man. So the next day he went to the office and resigned. He retired. Because he had the time in, but he would be in trouble if he's out there claiming he's sick and he's not. You don't do that. So he resigned, and at the Cat Club, I think you know the story. This is with Leonard. These was about, I don't know how many of them, but it was like three white guys with blue eyes, walking around in the Cat Club, and the saying is, they looked like they were from the KBG looking for Frankie. They only wanted to find Frankie because there was nobody else around doing the Lindy Hop. Al Mims had passed away, because okay. He started teaching them.
He went
them.
To Sweden, right?
Yes, he went to Sweden. He started teaching, but he got sick and he passed away. So who was left was Frankie Manning. Okay, so back to me. They got Frankie and they took him to Sweden. What happened? Frankie said, well, I got a son. Thank you. They brought me in because they were starting the Rhythm Hot Shots,
right.
And they had tap dancing and Lindy Hop, so they brought me in to teach them tap. So that's how I got them started in tap dancing, by going to Orang and teaching them.
You got the Rhythm Hot Shots started in tap dancing.
And yes, that was me.
Fantastic. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Los que no conocen esa historia es que en Nueva York en esos años Frankie era trabajando en el postal service, ¿no? y en un momento los de Suecia llegaron buscando este bailarín que vieron en las películas, ¿no? y así Frankie como salió de su retiro y empezó a dar clases otra vez, fue a Suecia, trajo jazz. Y así empezó, renació todo ese movimiento de swing. So, con Frankie y con Chazz, es el punto crítico en el mundo del Lindy Hop, que todo empezó otra vez.
Now, I had said that I went in the post office, yes, but I accumulated time. So, instead of taking vacation and staying in New York, I went to Sweden. And that's when I started teaching tap to Leonard and most of the other guys, Eddie and those guys, the Rhythm Hot Shots.
Yeah, and they're fantastic dancers.
Yes, because they really wanted, Leonard was, he just took his time. Mm-hmm. He said, I'll work on it, and he did for tap.
Yeah.
But Frankie really got, he got them to learn the swing outs and things like that. Mm-hmm. And if you know and seen the Rhythm Hot Shots back in those, they won the contest at the Apollo Theater.
Wow.
After that, yes, the Apollo Theater was on 125th Street. I had told you, when we came back from Caracas, Venezuela, I was with Norma and we went into the Apollo Theater. Well, the Apollo Theater was the one, not the only one, they had other entertainment within the theaters, but the Apollo Theater was the main theater on 125th Street. So I was able to go into that with Norma Miller when we came back from Caracas, Venezuela. Now we had jumped back to 1964 after we went and we came back, no jobs. Post office, I took my vacation time, went to Sweden, taught them. So now we are we have moved forward.
80-something, must be late 80s, early 90s?
Oh, now we're in the 90s, because we're in Sweden now.
Right.
And, yeah, I
have... Oh, it's so cold.
I've been very, very, very fortunate. Frankie and I have been going to Sweden for like 20 years, just before he passed. And I still have been going, so I've been going to Sweden every year. I'm so thankful. My health and everything has been kept up. I've been going there for like 25 years straight every year. So that is really something to be very, very happy about, which I am. So where are we?
Where are we? The Rhythm Hot Shots just won the Apollo Theater.
They got good. Somebody recommended, say, why don't you, you know, go into the contest at the Apollo Theater? And they thought it was a good idea, and they went into the Apollo. It's called Amateur Night, like on Wednesday night. They have different other acts and things. They went in there and tore the Apollo up.
Wow.
With the Lindy Hop, and they won. And they won the first prize. They were Frankie's proteges. Choreographed everything for them. We worked with them, so that was fabulous what he did.
And I don't imagine that's anything easy to come into the Apollo and win first place.
No, it isn't. But the Rhythm Hot Shots did it. If Leonard was here, he'll tell you all about it.
Right.
But I know that is a fact, and that is something to be proud of.
Was the next time that they were back in the Apollo with Frankie 100 after that?
Yes, that's right. Yes, and even myself, Frankie 100, I just felt so wonderful being there because I made my debut at the Apollo. I was 18 years old. To being back after all those years, back at the Apollo Theater, wow! It was just amazing. Yeah. It's really, really, really wonderful that Frankie 95. Have any of you were any of you there?
Frankie 100.
Frankie 100.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. All right. Frankie 100. Yes. Yes, I'm trying. Yes, Frankie 100. Frankie 100.
Oh, were there.
Yes.
They did the lights for you. They put you up on the stage.
They did?
Yep.
Yes, they did.
Oh, that's why I look so good.
We were the technicians of the lights.
No, don't turn it out. Oh, okay.
No. Perfection.
Italia was there too.
I didn't do anything.
She watched you look good. That's
so where are we?
Where are we? Well, I think we've reached the point when you've gotten the harangue, you've taught the Rhythm Hot Shots how to tap dance, Frankie taught them how to Lindy Hop, they're winning awards. And from there, how did your career continue as a dancer in those years? Because it seemed like you left the Postal Service around that same time. Or did you stay?
I stayed in the post office. What I did, I had mentioned that I started work at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and finished at say midnight, mm-hmm. and then I hung out. But what occurred to me, because I still taught, but I taught dancing for the Austin Dancing School on Saturdays.
That was in New York still.
Yeah, New York. Yeah, all of this is in New York. But I got this idea that if I work nights, that children get out of school at 3 o'clock, so I could teach kids during the week, and I could make some more money. Because again, I was married, and well, things happened that my wife and I, we split up, but I still took care of them. So now what I did, I say, well, I am going to start working the graveyard shift. That's what they call it. You go in at midnight and you get off at 8 o'clock in the morning. I'll go home and go to bed. And they wanted me to teach at this West Side Y, 63rd Street, Manhattan. I started teaching them, the youth department. Then I went to the adult department. I was making all kinds of good money, and I was very, very, very happy. I was tired, but it was a very good time of making money because my family was taken care of. Then I had a little extra money to travel and do things. And so I was just doing a lot of teaching there and very little performance. I performed when we had, I mentioned the Austin Dancers. The Austin Dancers had a school out in Queens, and I took my kids to dancing school every Saturday. So they could get a taste of what going on stage was. Mm-hmm. None of them became professionals. They were all, four of them, good social dancers.
Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. And then with Frankie, you re-entered in this world of indie hop, which kind of, as you saw it grow the way Frankie did. You saw it.
Yes. And I don't know, I had been teaching tap for a long time, but you can imagine, if I just dropped tap dance and just concentrated on the Lindy Hop along with Frankie, because people had their events, dance events like this one you had, and they liked the idea of father and son being there for the weekend. I taught tap, Frankie taught the Lindy Hop. Well, being with Frankie all the time, but I did not concentrate on Lindy Hop. I concentrated on teaching tap. But you can imagine, I could have learned much more Lindy Hop than I know now. I can get by on Lindy Hop. I can go out and have a good time. I can do little stage work. So, but if you, can you imagine if I had just stuck to Lindy Hop, I would really be a top-notch a Lindy Hopper, and that's it. But I can teach Lindy Hop, but I am not a Lindy Hopper. That's what I'm getting at. I am a dancer, and I can do the Lindy Hop, and I can teach it, but I'm not a Lindy Hopper.
I would say you are. I've seen you out there. I've seen you.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah. But wow. I think one thing I find very interesting is that you saw the entire scene kind of be reborn, and you were with it through its kind of all of its growth into what it is now, and you accompanied Frankie through that entire experience. And so, I think one thing maybe you have a little bit to share about what was Frankie's experience and your experience of that rebirth of the dance, and that must have been a very, very exciting and inspirational time for both of you.
Yes, because this is what developed what's happening now. My dad taught in Germany, Tokyo, and I was with him. And I seen the growth of the Lindy Hop. I was there. I watched the people come to the classes. And then when they have their Saturday night events, I see the places packed. I don't care where it was. Frankie didn't go to Russia. I did. I seen the way the Russians dance. They're dancing their butts off. Tokyo, they're dancing their butts off. Korea. The Mexicans are swinging and dancing their asses off. So Lindy Hop belongs to the world. It was originated in Harlem at the Savoy Ballroom. Now it belongs to everybody. And that's... what's so beautiful about it? That's what's so great about the dance. It's just, you see the happiness, the joy that it brings to people. So, what next?
think I would. Does anybody have any questions? I'd love to open up the floor for.
I have one question. I mean, thinking about what you were saying about rebirth of and three white guys coming to New York to pick you up, it seems like it's a repetition of a story of blues or jazz that it needed to be recognized outside of the US or picked up again before it was then brought back to the US. Was it in US? Was the scene somehow underground somewhere going all the time? I mean, these 20, 30 years that you said you were working in the postal service, was it?
Only sociably, like there was this a place, it's still called the Rainbow Room in Midtown Manhattan. They have a big band, and Frankie would go there for birthdays, and he would swing out. Frankie did not advertise the fact that he was a great dancer, but he took large groups, and they loved to watch Frankie dance, and he was doing the Lindy Hop, him and his girlfriend, they were good at that. And it was just something that started to catch on. Like I mentioned, the commercial was just a Gap commercial about some pants, but the music and the musicians started working, playing swing again. So it helped. Mm-hmm. It helped a whole lot of people. The teachers that they have today. There's more teachers than I know. I used to know all the teachers, but there's just more teachers now. Yeah. So it has done a lot for performers, for Lindy Hoppers, because if you have a partner and you get real good at it, and people recognize you, you might be called and say, look, we'd like for you to come and teach. And that's what happens. So the rebirth has done a lot for a lot, not only musicians, dancers, performers also. And performers that, like for instance, Naomi, she and Peter, they started out Lindy Hopping, but they found that Naomi could sing. Now she's singing her butt off, and she got musicians traveling with her. I think she'll be here next week, Naomi and the Handsome Devils. Are they coming here?
I wish they were.
Oh, no, I saw a flyer or something.
Kevin and Joe.
Huh? Okay.
Kevin and Joe
have
done it around. Yeah.
But really, that's what has happened. Some dancers became like musicians. And Naomi is one, and she had a voice, but this gave her the opportunity to start singing, and now she has her own little group, and she still teaches, so she's making some money now. Mm-hmm. It's wonderful. So the rebirth has benefited a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. It's created an industry.
Yes.
In many ways that stays within a family, where everybody's supporting everybody and doing amazing things. Yeah,
I am very happy. I'm the only one left from the Norman Miller, the boys. I'm the only one that's left. You know, I'm very, very, very fortunate, and that I still get to travel and go to the different places and teach what I know.
Yeah.
Because I've been out there a long time. People know me and they know my history. So they call me in. I'm expecting to go to Tokyo, back to Tokyo next year. I'm expecting to go to Singapore. I'm expecting to go to Barcelona. So I have some things to still look forward to. I'm very, very happy about that. And I'm very happy to be right here.
Insane. Any other questions? Anybody been thinking of something, burning questions, Lalo?
We have a lot of friends came here to Mexico to teach, and I think the swing now is a little bit mixed with other dances. So you that are a witness of this reborn, and you know how the original Lindy Hoppers dance, what do you, which country or which scene do you think is more similar to the origins of swing or Lindy Hop?
There's a few of them, but I say Sweden. I'd have to say Sweden because I've been going there for every year, like I said, at least 25 years, and I've watched the growth because they have a place to go to. Like the Savoy was a place to go to. They didn't teach or anything like that, but they went to the Savoy to see good dancing. Now you can go to these events and you learn you learn whatever they teach in salsa, Lindy Hop, or whatever the dance is. And that's, that's a very good question. I'm trying to see the best way I can answer it. You say, which place do I think that has the best scene? Wow.
The most original.
Oh, most original.
The most true to the origins, I guess.
Well, then I have to say Sweet, Harang. Because they are trying to, they will tell you, they try to hold the traditional and keep it as close to the traditional way Frankie used to teach. They try to keep that going. Yes.
Just a follow-up question, since we're talking about origins and what would you say, what influences were there before Lindy Hop? I mean, what influenced Lindy Hop in the first place? What were the elements that came into it? For Frankie, for example, where would he learn it from?
Well, Savoy Ballroom. The way it was told to me and the way that I understand it, because I wasn't quite here yet. Frankie at 15 went to the Alhambra, and that was like going to elementary school. And then he went to the Renaissance, that was like high school. And then they went to the Savoy. And at that time, Shorty Snowden was the king up at the Savoy Ballroom. You heard of the dance called the Shorty George? Well, that's referring to Shorty Snowden because he was very short. But Frankie idolized Shorty Snowden because he did a lot of his steps at the beginning when he started really learning how to do the Lindy Hop. So Shorty Snowden's group was the first. Really, because Frankie did not invent the Lindy Hop. Shorty Snowden was, and what they are saying is, like, you've heard of the word Lindy Hop came from Lindbergh, Charles Lindbergh, the pilot that flew from New York to Paris, and in the paper it says Lindy's Hop. So they asked Shorty Snowden, what dance are you doing? And this is the way it was told to me. And maybe most of you heard the same story. Shorty Snowden's answer was, I'm doing the Lindy Hop, Lindy's Hop, like that. So it became catchy. Now today you hear it by jitterbug and swing dancing. And if Norma was here, she would tell you, she would say, the Lindy Hop was being done at the Lower East State downtown Midtown Manhattan when Benny Goodman was appearing. Now all the Bobby Soxers, the dancers, would get up and dance in the aisles, and Benny Goodman said, this is from Norma, said, look at those jitterbugs. Now those jitterbugs, the dance of that time was the Lindy Hop. So that was the dance they did. But the word with jitterbug was so catchy that people started saying, oh, they're doing the jitterbug. That's how I was told that they started calling it the jitterbug. But it wasn't, the jitterbug was not a dance, but people get a lot of people together, they look like jitterbugs. So, but the dance of that day was the Lindy Hop. You following them?
Yeah.
Where was I? I get lost. I start talking and forget where I am. Did that help in any kind of way?
Yeah.
I'm glad.
Following the same question. Following.
Okay.
Following the follower. And how do you? Sorry, guys. Following with the no. How do you feel about these new mixes? Do you think it must keep it? We should keep it original, or is it's okay for you to see how other dancers start to do something new? Maybe they think it's more creative, or they wanna improve in some way. I don't know.
It cannot be stopped. Now, when Shorty Snowden was the king of the Savoy, Frankie group, the new guys in town, they start coming in, and Frankie was a good thief. I mean, he didn't steal nothing from you or nothing. He watch what you're doing, and boy, if you watch it enough, he'd get it like that. So he would take, he'd see what Shorty Snowden group was doing, and he'd take it back to Billy Ricker and Norm and them and show them. So they are the new youngsters coming in town, more or less. And they had, Frankie's group got so good that Whitey, who was a bouncer, and he was like, he picked the best dancers and put them in the Cat's Corner. So he got Frankie and the group, and he brought them in the Cat's Corner. So I said all that to say, there's always gonna be new blood coming in with different ideas. And there will be mixes and changes and things like that. But all you do is just remember where it came from. And that mix, so like in Harang, they try to keep it too close to a traditional as possible. And here's one thing that I see, and you can't stop it. Like for instance, on a swing out, you'll see like Frankie would go like this, with that arm and the back. Now you see a lot of dancers, and they just turn, and that arm just stays like this and dangle. But this gave it style, but this was the Savoy style. And you can't make people do this everywhere, but that's how you recognize, that's how, like if I go to Germany and I see a couple on the floor, and if I see them do that, Frankie's been there. But today there are new teachers and whatnot, so you'll see a move that maybe Kevin, he's coming here next week, has taught. So it's that mix and new people coming in which is changes it, but we try to keep it as close to the original as possible. That's all we can do, as long as we just keep bringing them in to dance. That's the main thing. Have the people to come out to enjoy themselves and the joy of doing the Lindy Hop and know where it came from. Thank you very much.
Maybe I have just like, can you talk to us a little bit about what happened with the musicians? Like, what's happening in this context? What is Count Basie doing in that moment? Did you meet Ella Fitzgerald? Did you meet her physically?
No. I wish I had her. I've seen her perform, but I never actually met her. Frankie knew her very, very, very well because she sang at the Savoy Ballroom. I didn't get up to the Savoy until 1958, and shortly in 1958, they finally closed and the building came down to put other buildings up. But I did get to actually meet Count Basie, Cab Calloway, and I, and they knew that I was Frankie's son. And they just, hey, you know, they'd come in, they'd come upstairs, they might open the door and say, hey, they didn't call me Chazz then, they just said hello to everybody. So I had the pleasure of really working with Duke Ellington in a show called Jump for Joy. And this quick thing I wanted, not quick, but it was something about Duke Ellington that my father experienced, and I experienced the exact same thing. Frankie's group act were appearing with Duke Ellington. So Frankie got his music together, and he took his music to Duke Ellington. Duke Ellington standing up there, you know, he was sharp, and that's Duke Ellington. He looks at the music, and he said, well, we don't play this. So Frankie told him that, well, this is the music I have. So he told Billy Strayhorn or somebody, he said, pull out the B section, just to say something. They pulled out some other music and played it, and it went perfectly with what Frankie was doing. Can you realize that this is something? Because Frankie tells this story. So now, I always rehearsed the music for Norma Miller and the Four Jazzmen. I took the music to Duke Ellington. He looked at the music, the exact same thing. We don't play this. So he told one of the other musicians, he said, and I remember this, get out red shoes. And he played red shoes for the rehearsal for us, and it worked perfectly. He was a genius, Duke Ellington. So how he did it, but he looked at what you did, and he put other music right to it, and it fit. So, I mean, Frankie always got along with musicians, and I used to know all of the musicians in Count Basie band. But because the two of them, I mean, they are playing for you. They are playing for you. And we, at the Apollo Theater, you did four shows a day, Monday to Friday. On Saturdays, you did five shows. And on Sunday, you did five shows. We were young. So when it came time, you went out there and you danced your butt off. It was wonderful. I mean, so musicians were very important. And today, Lindy Hop, the rebirth of Lindy Hop, brought in musicians back playing again, playing swing. And I swear, you just for your own, just stop a musician and just ask them, how you enjoy playing swing. Just ask them, just, and then you'll find out for yourself. But I think they're loving it. Because it's work. It's work. They're going to play for rap? Why are they going to play for rap? But for swing, they can get out there and blow. As you see it, like Friday night, the big band, and all the bands that play, they're playing for you to get out there and do your thing. I hope I answered your question that you asked an hour ago.
let's go with two more questions. No. Start with Clau and one more, so whoever's got the burning one.
Okay. I would really like to know if back in those, like in 40s, I know you were born, live it, but yeah. But if it was like a real social dance, you know, like here in Mexico, if there's party, then you listen to cumbia or salsa or Latin rhythms, and half of the people probably in the party, they go up there and dance. So I would like to know if swing dance was spread all over, or it was only for those like ballrooms we have been talking about. I don't know if there was a concert of swing, many people got up and danced, or it was only for special places. I mean, if it was a real social dance spread around the country, or not so much.
Well, it was the Lindy Hop was a dance that did spread around the country. I hope I'm answering your question correctly. From the Savoy Ballroom. Now you know that they didn't have television back in those days. So the only way it started to spread is when Whitey starts sending the Savoy dancers like Frankie and them to perform different places. And they were going out to California. They went out there, they didn't go by plane, they went out by buses. And when they stopped in different places going to California, as I was told, Whitey would put, they had a jukebox, they put money in the jukebox and had them dance. So people start seeing this on their way out to California. You've heard of, what's it, Dean Collins. Well, the way I understand it, Dean Collins came to the Savoy Ballroom and he learned to dance at the Savoy Ballroom. He left the Savoy Ballroom, went out to California and started a Lindy Hop out the West Coast. That's how you got the West Coast swing. Dean Collins started that out in out there, but it didn't originate out there. So on the way to driving out to California, that's how it started to spread. And also the soldiers that came out of Harlem, going to different parts of the world, they start taking swing to Germany, wherever they were stationed. So social, it became social dancing after days. Before that, they were, I don't know what they were doing, two steps or foxtrot or something. But I'm talking about the Lindy Hop started to spread as a social dance. And I'm not talking about the flipping and all of that. That was for the show. But social dance and swing outs and turns and this ordinary swing music to the swing music. I hope that I answered sort of.
Follow-up. Just since she's asking about the like if it was so prevalent, what about the racial divide? Was it mostly black people dancing, or was it already in the 40s, 50s mixed, or when did it become integrated, let's say?
Well, the way that I, the Frankie and Norma told it, the Savoy Ballroom was the only ballroom was not segregated. White people came, and especially movie stars. White people came from downtown, uptown to Harlem just to see them dance. And a lot of your stars, Clark Gable, James Cagney, and all of those stars, they would have a special place for them to sit. Nobody bothered them. They just came and whites and blacks danced together in the Savoy Ballroom. Now, it could not be done anywhere else. Once you left the ballroom, the white people went down to where they lived and danced, but we could not go. So that is the only thing that we really had. And that, because you're talking about the depression. So dancing was the only outlet that that the black people had in Harlem. They went out to dance and was only, like about 25 cents to go in to listen to these big bands that they had, Chick Webb. You know what, Chick Webb, Ella Fitzgerald, and people like that.
25 cents to see Ella Fitzgerald.
And as well as the Savoy was as well like one day salsa or like Latino American rhythms.
Mambo, I guess.
Mambo.
Well, yeah, mambo started coming out in the fifties. I remember the name Machito, was one. Xavier Cugat was the rumba king.
Yeah.
He was more or less a rumba king. But that's how they slowly started playing Latin. But Machito played at the Savoy Ballroom. they have nights that they would have Latin dance, and that's when they were doing mostly the rumba and then into the mambo. That's when we didn't hear the word salsa until not too long ago, maybe about what, 10 years maybe? Something like that. So they had Latin bands come into the Savoy Ballroom. And then later on, the famous Palladium downtown, where you had, Mambo King. Help me, somebody, help me.
Perez Prado, no, he didn't die.
I remember the Perez Prado, we used some of his music. He had some great music. But everybody knows the name that I'm trying to think of. I know you know his name.
It's for a dancer?
They played the mambo.
Tito Puente.
Tito Puente?
There you go. I told you that somebody in here knows. Tito Puente, yeah. We used to go to a place called the Palladium in Manhattan. And with Tito Puente, that place was packed. So you had the Savoy with swing. And then at certain nights, you had Machito up in Harlem. And I don't know if Tito ever came up. I know Tito played at the Apollo. me, at the Apollo. Because I know I was there. Because I love the Latin dancing also. I love the music just as well.
There's hay un documental muy interesante que se llama Del Mambo al Hip Hop. Lo pueden checar en YouTube, y sale justamente toda la historia de cómo inicia toda la parte latina, también mismo en Manhattan, en otro cuartier, no en Harlem, era en Bronx. Y está también muy, muy interesante, se ve cómo la historia tanto latina como justamente del swing son primos, son completamente... cuates, vaya, ¿no? Se puede ver también en el Savoy cómo se podía compartir las noches, y entonces no hay una pelea entre la salsa ni el swing, al contrario, son cuates.
And it goes into the Savoy days, and the whole Latin culture mixed with swing, and then it coming up into...
Yeah, that's a really nice... It's like 40 minutes max.
Oh yeah, I'll try to find out who has it so I can...
On YouTube has it.
Oh, YouTube, yeah. Okay, yeah. I'll look it up.
Thanks to YouTube.
I do have a question.
Okay, we're gonna go one last question with Tao. I have a burning question also, and then there we're gonna call it. So Tao, go.
So my burning question is, obviously taking the advantage that 5 years of really working, I remember talking one day at Kerrang, one of the talks at the meetings, and we had the chance actually to ask Frankie directly, and we were really interested into building a scene, but we knew that we had nothing to build on but ourselves, so like it was really hard, and he told us that it was through the music that we could really get a like start to teach swing dancing, like we should actually first let people know about the music, get them involved or in love with the music, and therefore then we can start teaching them some like steps and stuff so that they can actually start to get it.
Mm-hmm.
I think after 5 years we have made it so far, not only through the music, because that's the next step for us really, but it has been really like a very amazing trip, and I remember like a lot that kind of question that we had like since many, many years. And now I could ask you, Chazz, now what, knowing you meeting all of us, there's a lot of people who is just starting, some other who has been dancing for 3 years, some other for 5 years, that has been since the day one of our first class and stuff, and they're here. And I don't know, like, I think, like, we keep on telling them what we feel is best for the community, because that's something that we do for the community, it's not for ourselves. otherwise I'll be doing something different probably. Mm-hmm. But I think like I'd like you to tell us right now what you feel like. What would you suggest as a way to keep this growing in a safe way, in a friendly environment? Like, we want to dance, that's what we want to do. And I don't know if you have some kind of...
Well, what I want to say is, you have experienced, like, for Friday, you have been, for 5 years, you've been listening to swing music. You know where it started, how it started. And if you love what you're doing, it is your responsibility to go out and say, listen, I love swing music. I want you to come with me tomorrow night. We're going to listen to some swing music. You reach out to other people. And if you love what you're doing, if you don't, well, then you're wasting your time. I went out on the dance floor, I see happy people. So take that happiness a little step further. You know a friend lived next door, or down the street, around the corner? Tell them about this experience and ask them, say, come with me and listen to the music. Let them, again, listen to the music, and if they have any sign of and enjoy the music, then next step is to learn the dance. It worked 40, 50, 60 years ago. It's working in Tokyo, Japan, Russia, and I say, why not happen here? But it's, you can't just sit and not do nothing about it. Ask other people to come. Say, look, I have a wonderful time going to, what's the name of the place? The ballroom?
Salon Los Angeles.
Yes, Los Angeles. Come with me. Tell people about your experiences. I hope this, I'm making sense of what I'm saying.
Yes.
Because that's what I believe you need to do. That's how you're going to get other people that don't know about it. If you like what's happening and you want to build a scene, that's a way that what I believe that can happen. Thank you very much.
Well, I think we can wrap it up.
I can finish my drink.
I think you can finish your drink. Chazz, I think it's for me it's really important to tell you that the last 2 days have been really magical, and I think we had an incredible combination of just coincidences and amazing experiences, and also a lot of planning that went into it. But with the combination of the competition slash this big band that appeared out of nowhere and played some of the most incredible charts that I've ever heard a big band play, in Mexico in a salon with Pachuco's dancing with dance on the
mambo. Yes, 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 yes.
There was something very, very, how do you say, like, I don't know, how do you say, like a
textual, no?
Something, there was just a lot of texture in that moment. There was a lot of
richness.
A lot of
richness.
Richness,
yes.
Yeah.
Diversity.
Yeah. I think that, I don't know, I feel very fortunate that you got to see that, because that was for us also a first moment in the beginning of something, a beginning of a new adventure for us in the swing scene in Mexico, and it's something that I think you're going to get to see develop, and the next time that you come, you're going to see where that road has taken us. And so I'm just so thankful that you could be here for that, and I can't wait to share the next step with you.
I'm just thankful that you thought enough of me. You know, I came out to the wedding, and I was impressed at the wedding in that little barn when they were swinging out in the barn. I said, hey, look at it. Because it's the truth. Mexican dancing, I'm talking about for me. If I went to the movies, I see the big sombrero hat, or a mariachi musicians and what they mean. What they play. I didn't know that anything else was going on. When they said swinging in Mexico, I just didn't understand, because I thought that your culture didn't allow you to move away. But they did it in Japan when they do, you know, their Japanese dancing, and Chinese do their Chinese dancing, and Singapore and Africa and all of that. They're swinging in Africa too, again. So why not here in Mexico? So you all are swinging, and I loved it at the wedding, and I enjoyed the weekend that I've been here this time. And this is the truth. You answered your own question. I love to watch you. You show the joy that happened many, many years ago. That's what people like, because people are out there smiling and really enjoying the dance. You don't have to be throwing the girls, all of you just get out there and enjoy the music. Enjoy each other. I can't think of any more, and I really appreciate Tim saying, hey, Chazz, we were thinking about having you come out. And I said, yeah. But after saying yeah, and I said, well, wow. Are they going to be wearing sombreros? But when I walked in on Friday, boy, they were sharp. The guys, cats with the big hat with the feather, and just pachucos, or pachaco. And they were dancing. Oh, wow. Oh, they look so good. I said, look at here. They don't have no sombreros on. Yeah.
I think we're gonna go to a new adventure for sure. I'm really curious on discovering this terminology that I'm starting to know, that is the Mexican swing. Because my experience right now this weekend with this Salon Los Angeles was the first time we approached this salon, the first time that the salon is opening the doors to Swing Mexico, and it's been like a magic combination. I felt that Swing Mexico felt in love with whatever Salon Los Angeles was offering, and I felt also that Salon Los Angeles felt in love with Swing Mexico. I feel that we kind of found each other a super powerful bond, and also I feel very excited for the next days to come, because I feel that in Mexico there is a very strong tradition from dancing, and social dancing is really powerful here. So when I start seeing all these pachucos, when they say, I do swing dance, but they don't know what is a swing out. So there is like this contradiction, no? He said that he swing dance, I said that I swing dance, but my opinion is that they don't know how to swing out. So no, so this mm-hmm. I feel it's like finding each other.
Yes.
I was telling you the other day, I feel that I am finding the bound of my culture, of my own country, from the eyes of an American culture. But I'm very excited of going around in Mexico City, knowing more about Mexico, learning what these people say about swing, what's their Mexican swing, knowing more about the Pachuco story, and really trying to find like a path that bounds us, like and allows us to flourish something new. Mm-hmm. And the Salon Los Angeles, just everybody knows, I can tell you right now what's happening. The Salon Los Angeles just got this super exciting experience with us dancing in the dance floor. And they were just impressed. They were like with their head like this, like falling in love again. And they are impressed that we are young people, that is not a lot of... No, when we go to the Salon Los Angeles one Tuesday, I hope we all go together, we're gonna see that it's really above 70 years old. There is no younger people. So when we were there swinging, the owner, Armida Nieto, told me like, I'm really just cannot express how lucky I feel that your movement, Swing Mexico, is really wishing to be part of Salon Los Angeles, because that's the way they are like breathing, that they are saying something new can happen and not we are dying in our in our traditions, because they feel they are dying because no other young people are entering in the ballroom. There is no young people dancing in there. There is no swing dancing in there, but the pachucos doing their six count swing Mexican style swing dance, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So they haven't seen ever a swing out in that place, but we brought it. So right now I'm super, the last days it's been just like breathing out and really compromising again with this project. And not just me and Pau funding it 5 years ago, but right now it's like 5 years ago happened, and right now we are writing the new story all together. And having you here for us, for me, it's really, I feel like supported. Like, I feel like I have someone that knows, I feel that someone that knows the story and has been going through all these beautiful stories back in those days. Like, I feel supported with you. Like, I told him the other day, I can feel what Leonard felt when they found Frankie many years ago, and Frankie was helping them to build up the Renaissance,
yes,
Lindy Hop in Sweden. But right now, like, you are experiencing everything that we're experiencing right now. Like, I feel like really supported that you are knowing what we're doing and we're able to share it. And it's like, I feel like a, not grandpa and grandchild relation, but you know, like when you ask your, when I ask my grandma, like, hey, how do I bake those cookies that I love, no? She just give me the recipe, like, because she knows that she needs to pass that to keep life going, right? Like, to keep it running. So right now, it's just like, no, hey, let's bring Chaz for the anniversary. Let's do it. Like, call him. Are you really gonna do it? Yeah, call him, call him. We were there in the back phone, like, ask him if he wanna come for the anniversary, you know? And we did it. I was just planning a party. But right now, I feel that it's more than just a party, you know? It's really something that is changing my compromise to Swing Mexico, and it's changing the compromise that all these people that we're already a big family, we are starting to commit together and being able to share it with you. And oh, you put us to work today, man. Like, oh, man. I really felt like, oh, there is something beyond of what I thought and what I can teach. You can come here and put us to work like this. And we were all so, our minds, our brains were just like, and I just wanna start tomorrow again and start repeating and challenge ourselves so we can really grow and see what beautiful thing can come out of here, right? And I really think, I'm really thankful to life that we can be sharing it together, because it's been supported. It's like, okay, Chaz know what is happening, and for me that's very important. It's very important that you know that we are doing this, right?
Yes, yes.
And I'm
really
thankful that life is allowing us for this chance, and I'm really looking forward to bring Dawn Hampton one day, this beautiful lady.
Yes.
She's also a very good friend of us, no? And just very last thought that she's been talking a lot about if the whole world will swing dance,
there will be no war.
And right now in Mexico City, you know, like Mexico and the whole country, we're suffering about all these conflicts and vulnerabilities and economics and politics and narcotráfico and extortions and all this, like, war. It's a war, like, it's happening. And I feel that let's swing dance, because if Dawn and you and Frankie said that if the whole world was swing dancing, there would be no war, I truly believe on that.
Well, there's something to believe, whether we can stop all wars That remains to be seen.
Yeah.
But we do know that it brings the great people together like yourselves. Now, you heard her, what she has to say, and you are here because you are supporting Tim and Arush and Abau. You are here supporting, and how you can do more is to say, your next door neighbor or someone to say, hey, this is what we're doing. Why don't you come by and see what you're doing? And bring in more people to support what they are trying to do. 5 years, you had to work. It was hard work, but it made you want to do more because now you have a place. What you were telling me, you didn't have a place to have classes before this. You tried and tried. Now you have this place, and you're starting like something new because you have this place, and you're gonna have more students coming in, but they. Loving what they are learning is the key. And this love has been going on throughout these countries that I named a little while ago. I think I've talked enough. I hope that, I hope what I said that you will take it to heart and help support them like you have been. Yes. I'll drink to that. Tim seen that, Andrew seen that I have my rum and coke every now and then. And it's just been a wonderful experience. I too am watching something grow into like a flower. This is the growth of swing, Mexican swing. You here are experiencing the growth, and you just watch. It's only going to get
bigger.
And practice.
Yes.
And better.
And better, yes.